Yes.
And so let me introduce today's speaker, Onerva Korhonen. Onerva is a postdoc at the Center for Biomedical Technology at the Polytechnical University of Madrid. I became aware of Onerva and their work through a recommendation by my friend Tavayer Lovewood, and was immediately hooked. So the way that we construct networks from data determines a lot about what we can and cannot learn from the networks that we constructed. And so I think that even though Onerva is going to focus on networks and neuroscience, there's a lot of lessons that we can learn from today's talk that apply to kind of a very broad network science perspective. So Onerva, take it away.
Thanks for the introduction and thanks for the invitation. Special thanks to Talaye. She's actually my so-called PhD sister. We sat in the same office for 4 years. So thanks for the nomination. And today I'll indeed talk about networks of the brain, in particular about functional brain networks. My title is The Quest for Consistency, How to Not Construct Functional Brain Networks. The Quest for Consistency was the title of my PhD thesis. And when I started that in 2014, I thought that, I will actually study some properties of brain networks. And then when we were working on the first paper, I quite quickly realized that no way, I'm not going to study any network properties because I don't really know how to construct that network. So today I'll talk a bit about what are functional brain networks. Then I'll talk about how they are constructed now, and then quite a bit about how they shouldn't be constructed now, and finally close with a couple of words about how they possibly should be constructed in the future. And I'm not really used to this sort of like remote talking, so it feels really weird because I can't see the audience. But if you have any questions, any comments, please go ahead, ask in the chat or do whatever Zoom magic you want to do so that I could feel that you are actually around. The slides can be found online. There's the link and it will appear again in the end. So let's get started. First, this is kind of an obvious question. Why should we study the brain, especially the human brain, as a network? There is a beautiful network picture from one of our papers. And actually, what is our brain? Our brain is a system of neurons, systems of neuronal cells. And neurons really like to connect to each other. Basically, if you take some neurons and separate them from each other, they either tend to build new connections or then they die out. Some people in our lab are actually doing that with neurons of grasshoppers. So they unfortunately need to kill the poor little grasshopper. Then they take the neurons, keep the anatomical positions, cut all connections, and in around 2 weeks, they see that the neurons have grown together, formed a new network. So our brain is actually a network of neurons. Then from brain anatomy, we know that it's not just a network of neurons, but it's a network of kind of collections or groups of neurons. So we have different brain areas, and then we have axon bundles, so the parts of neurons that are connecting the different areas. So we have a network of brain structure. And then there's a widely shared view in human neuroscience that the brain areas, they don't work, they don't function in separation, but actually the normal healthy human brain function is based on collaborations and interactions between brain areas. So in a sense, we have a set of elements, those brain areas or neurons that tend to connect, tend to interact. So we have relationships between them. So we indeed do have a network. The field that studies the brain as network is called network neuroscience. This is actually a very new term. When I started my PhD in 2014, I didn't have a name for my field. I tended to call myself a physicist who's interested in the networks of the human brain. And then, luckily, in 2016, Sarah Maldon and Daniel Bassett came up with the term network neuroscience. That was then further elaborated by Daniel Bassett and Olaf Spohns in 2017. And now I can tell you that I'm a network neuroscientist. This makes life easier. So network neuroscience is just applying network-based tools on the brain. Roughly speaking, there are two aims. First of all, we want to understand how the healthy brain works, what happens under different circumstances, when we are performing different tasks, when we are resting, when we are sleeping, and then also how can the kind of disorganization of the brain network structure cause different diseases. There are a lot of neurological or psychological diseases that are somehow associated with problems in the network structure, for example, Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease or different autism spectrum disorders or epilepsy. They are all to some extent considered as network diseases. Now, the network neuroscience is kind of an umbrella term. It covers a lot of different things. We have very broad scales, both spatially and temporally. Spatially, basically, the scale starts from interactions that happen inside neurons at the level of molecules, at the level of genes. Then we have interactions between neurons, interactions between brain areas, and also interactions between human beings. There are things called multi-person neuroscience, where you, for example, image the brain function of two people in the same time, and then see how the, for example, how the brain of somebody listening to a story reacts on the story and the story-induced changes in the brain of the one who is telling the story. So it's really in-the-person neuroscience. And also temporally, basically the interactions inside neurons, they happen at this scale of, let's say, milliseconds. So that is like the smallest scale we can measure, and then it goes up until even years. So basically networks of the brain, they vary with aging over years. So that is the temporal scale. Typically, we separate the three different types of brain networks. So we have structural networks, which are actually existing physical objects. So we have brain areas, we have axon bundles between them, and that is what we call structural connectivity, structural brain networks. Then we have functional brain networks, which is what I will talk about today. And these are networks of temporal coactivation. So basically we have two brain areas that have time series of activation, and if those time series of activation are similar, so basically if they are correlated, we think that, okay, these two brain areas, they must be interacting, and we say that there is a functional connection between them. What is important to understand, of course, is that this correlation is not causality. So basically you can't really say that you have a functional network of interactions, but we have a functional network of similar behavior that may indicate interaction. Finally, the third class of brain networks is actually networks of causality. We talk about effective brain networks, which means that when something actually happens in one brain area, that then somehow affects the action of or activity in other brain areas. These are very difficult to construct. I don't really understand how people do that. So I'll stick with the functional ones for today. Before getting to the network construction, some words about where does our data come from. So basically I'm working with human data, and human data collected with methods that don't harm the subject, non-invasive methods. The two main classes are functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, and then we have electrophysiological measures, MEG and EEG. I'll return to those in a moment. For fMRI, it's collected with that tube-like thingy. So basically, if you have ever broken your knee or something and had that imaged, that's done with the same machine. Also, if, for example, they suspect that somebody has a brain tumor, then the head can be imaged with the magnetic resonance imaging device. It has to see what is the structural situation. fMRI adds on top of that the functional component. This is based on properties of blood or properties of hemoglobin, to be more exact. And the basic idea is that hemoglobin that carries oxygen is magnetically different from hemoglobin that doesn't. So they behave differently in a magnetic field. In fMRI, we have a very strong magnetic field. And basically, that causes different areas of the brain give a different response signal that we can measure. So basically, in fMRI, we can localize those brain areas that have a lot of oxygen. Then there's a kind of assumption, he's not sure, but his assumption that those areas that are functioning actively, they need more oxygen. That's understandable, the neurons need oxygen. And because of that, those areas that we see having a lot of oxygen are actually those that are active. So we can construct for each area a time series of activation based on the level of oxygen. The measurement unit is voxel. Voxel is basically a 3D pixel, so it's a small cube of brain matter, typically edges of a couple of millimeters. The spatial resolution of fMRI is great, absolutely great. The temporal resolution is bad. Not absolutely bad, but bad. So at the range of around seconds. And now that we remember that things actually happen at the millisecond scale, then our 1 second resolution is pretty low. The other class of functional neuroimaging is the electromagnetical one. So we have the electroencephalogram, EEG, and magnetoencephalography, MEG. Both of these are based on the fact that the interactions between neurons are electrical. So basically, every time when a neuron does something that generates an electrical field, a changing electrical field, that induces a magnetic field. And now EEG measures that electrical field, it's measured with the gap, as you can see there on the top left. And MEG measures the magnetic field, measured with the MEG device that is shown on the right. And then when we apply some mathematics to inverse modeling, we can actually transform the time series measured outside of the head into time series on the brain surface. The temporal resolution of MEG and EEG is terrific, around the rates of milliseconds. The spatial resolution is low and depends hugely on the quality of the inverse model. So basically, fMRI and MEG, EEG are complementing each other. One of them gives important information about timing, and other one very important information about location of activity. So what we do when we have neuroimaging data from MEG or EEG or fMRI. That is some sort of like rough how to construct a functional brain network scheme. So we start from neuroimaging signal. That is not actually neuroimaging signal, that's some white noise I simulated. I didn't tell you that. So we start from the signal. Some level of pre-processing is always needed. There is typically a lot of noise in the measurements. The measurement devices are pretty sensitive to, well, all sort of electrical devices you might have around, to the light bulbs. If you have a tram passing your laboratory, you can see that in the data, all sort of things like that. So pre-processing is always needed. Then the data is measured at voxels or at the MEG, EEG sensors or at source points. However, those are not always, not typically used as the network nodes. Typically, we combine multiple voxels together or multiple MEG, EEG source points together, so there's some
Onerva, I think we're losing you. I'm going to stop your video in case it helps, if it's still possible.
We don't have kind of natural node candidates. Typically in many networks, if you have a social network, it is clear that, yeah, the nodes are the people. If you study the internet, it's clear that, yeah, the web pages are the links, are the nodes. If you have a transportation network, it's pretty clear that, yeah, the nodes are stops or stations. In a brain network, it's not clear what are the nodes. Of course, one could think that, yeah, but you have neurons. The brain is a network of neurons. Why not to use neurons as nodes? As you can imagine, if we want to study the whole human brain, we just can't measure the neurons. We don't see them. We don't have any imaging technologies so far that would be able to see single neurons. So every time when somebody studies single neurons, that is done, but that's always done in animals and typically in vitro. So basically first killing the animal and then taking some slices of the brain tissue and analyzing them, unfortunately. And now this lack of natural node candidates causes that we have a lot of different node definitions used in the field. Actually, the number of nodes used to study the human brain may vary from a couple of tens up to a couple of tens of thousands. So there's a huge variation. And we know that actually the observed network properties depend a lot about the number and the definition of nodes. So in my opinion, before constructing any network, one should actually pay a lot of attention on how to define the nodes. And I'll mostly talk about fMRI today, because that's what I have been working on. In fMRI, the basic question is, should our nodes be the measurement voxels, or should they be larger areas called regions of interest, or ROIs? As I told earlier, voxels are the fMRI imaging resolution, so this is basically the highest spatial resolution you can get with fMRI. On the other hand, it's often said that the signals of voxels are noisy, so basically somehow clumping them together and averaging might help to get rid of some of the noise to improve the signal-to-noise ratio. A normal human head contains around 10,000 voxels, depending on the imaging resolution, which then means that if we take the voxels as nodes, we have a network of 10,000 nodes, an adjacency matrix of 10,000 times 10,000. Neuroscientists very often work with MATLAB. MATLAB can't really cope such a big matrix. So that has been a limiting factor for the voxel level analysis. The ROIs, on the other hand, as said, they are collections of voxels, so multiple voxels clumped together. They are defined based on brain anatomy, basically saying that between that gyrus and that sulcus, we have an area. They can be defined based on function, meaning that in some earlier study, we have noticed that these voxels behave similarly. Okay, they will be a ROI. Or even based on connectivity, again observed in earlier studies, that okay, these voxels seem to have similar connectivity patterns to the rest of the brain. Let's call them an ROI. Independent of how our ROIs are defined, they should be homogeneous, meaning that all the voxels inside an area should be doing the same thing. That's because to obtain the ROI time series, we almost always average the voxel time series. Now then, if the voxel time series are very different, we basically lose information in the averaging. So the question is, how violent is actually clumping together averaging the voxel time series? I will next tell about the two studies we have already conducted, two published papers, and then about a couple of projects that are still ongoing, all of them more or less related to the homogeneity of ROIs and how that is connected to the network structure. Let's start with this one, consistency of regions of interest as nodes of fMRI functional brain networks, published in Network Neuroscience 2017 by me and other people from Aalto University Finland, where we actually asked, what should be the nodes of functional brain networks? Should they be ROIs or should they be voxels? And are our ROIs functionally homogeneous? I won't go into details of methods, but basically we had two sets of data. I'll today show results for one of them. They were measured at Aalto. We had time series of 215 time points, around 6 minutes. There you can see that the temporal resolution of fMRI is low. We used ROIs from three different atlases, two anatomical ones, so those between that landmark and that landmark, we have an area, and one connectivity-based. The results I saw will be from one of the anatomical ones, and then we investigated connectivity both at the level of voxels and at the level of regions. And we started by asking, are the voxels inside the regions actually similar to each other? So we calculated the correlations between voxels that belong to the same region, that's shown in blue, or that belong to different regions, that's shown in green. And here we can see that, yes, voxels that belong to the same region are more correlated than voxels that belong to different regions. That's good. But as you can see, there is also a huge overlap between the distributions, telling that our regions are not as homogeneous as we would hope. So we went on to define a measure for homogeneity. We called this spatial consistency. And it's simply put just the average correlation coefficient between voxels that belong to the same region. It is pretty straightforward to calculate. It's easy to interpret. Basically, if we have spatial consistency of 1, our region is perfect. That's exactly what we wanted to have. If we have spatial consistency of 0, our region is doing terribly badly. It's basically a collection of random voxels. And for all those three atlases we checked, our spatial consistency peaks around 0.2, telling that no way our regions, our ROIs are not homogeneous. So the whole assumption behind this approach doesn't actually hold too bad. What does that mean from the viewpoint of network structure, from connectivity? What we did, we calculated the connectivity at level of voxels, that's on left, level of ROIs, that's on right. At voxel level, we calculated the average correlation between voxels in this ROI and in that ROI. So that's the average of correlations. At the ROI level, we calculated just the correlation between the ROI time series, so that's correlation of averages. As a function of the mean consistency of two ROIs, what we see is that at the level of voxels, the strongest links we can see, I hope you can see them, are between ROIs that are consistent, which is understandable. And we don't see any links between ROIs that are not consistent, which is understandable, because if we have a clump of non-correlated voxels here, another one there, these two just can't be correlated to each other by the definition of correlation. At the level of ROIs, however, we do see strong links between areas that are not consistent. I don't know how to interpret these links, but I think there's a danger that these are actually spurious. These are links we shouldn't be seeing. These are actually corrupting our observed network structure. So to conclude, the ROIs are not always functionally homogeneous. That hold for all those three atlases we investigated. We see strong ROI level correlations, basically network links between areas that are not homogeneous. These links may be spurious. And then this kind of leaves open the question, why are our ROIs so non-homogeneous? I was about to say that, but so non-homogeneous. Is it just that they are badly defined? Could we come up with a new atlas with better ROIs, and that's all perfect? Or is it just that the noise level at voxels is so high, meaning that actually we see that we don't see voxels being correlated, but then when we average, we get rid of individual noise and kind of get some sort of true underlying signal? Or could it be that actually those ROIs we see having low consistency are just idling, not doing anything? That was motivation for the second paper I'll present today from 2018. Regions of interest as nodes of dynamic functional play networks, again done together with some people from Aalto. Elisa Ryppö was doing her master's thesis with us. She was brilliant. Unfortunately for the academy, left academy after doing her master's. I'm trying to tell her to come back, but she hasn't promised to return yet. Let's see in some years. So we asked,
before we move on, we do have one question, I think, on the first part. So I'm just going to interject here. So,
yes.
There's a question in the chat from Sebastian. Have you checked these results on functional network postulations like the Schaefer postulation? You know what that is? I don't know what the Schaefer postulation is.
We haven't checked with that one, but we checked with the brain atom, that is a kind of a combination of connectivity and function based, and then we checked with two of the Cradock atlases that are innocent. Also, they are not like strictly function based, they are also observed by clustering the voxel level connectivity network. So actually, we haven't checked with any like truly and fully function based. That should be definitely be done. In a sense, they should be performing better than the others. This basically, like in network science, everybody wants to have their own community detection method. In network neuroscience, everybody wants to have their own method for defining ROIs.
Mm.
I do as well, of course. I hope I can at some point. So, in the second study, we asked, okay, if our ROIs are not that brilliant nodes of static brain networks, how do they work in dynamic ones? Because we know the brain networks are changing in time. And in particular, how does spatial consistency change in time? Because we knew that on average it is pretty low, but is it pretty low just because it's always low? Or is it pretty low because it's actually fluctuating? If we average like peaks and whatever is the opposite of a peak, then we observe something like in the middle. Let's see. Here we again have two sets of data. ROIs from three different postulations. Now the results will be for brain atom, which is connectivity based. And then we divided our data into time windows of 80 samples. And again, because of the temporal resolution of fMRI, we allowed the time windows to overlap by 50% in order to get enough of them. We used two measures. We had the spatial consistency, the measure of functional homogeneity that I just defined, and then we introduced spatial-temporal consistency to measure the time dependency of spatial consistency. The formula looks ugly, but it's just the average relative change in spatial consistency between two time windows. So basically how much our spatial consistency is changing on average. And this is what we see. So all the small blobs are ROIs located based on anatomy. So the nose is up and left hemisphere on left, right on right. And basically we have here the changes between all our window pairs, so from window 1 to 2 and so on. And we can see that indeed spatial consistency do change in time. So we have areas whose consistency has increased, those are the red ones, and areas whose consistency has decreased, those are the blue ones. And from that data, we calculated the spatiotemporal consistency, showing that we have some areas that tend to keep the original consistency, and then we have some other ones whose consistency is changing a lot over time. Here the stimulus was just free music listening, so the subjects were lying in the scanner listening to music. Because of that, we can't really tell what would be the like functional meaning of changes in consistency. We only see that yes, it is changing. Then we wanted to have a closer look what happens inside the ROIs, how it is changing. So we picked two ROIs with high spatial consistency, the upper rows, and two with low spatial consistency, the bottom rows. as you can see in the high spatial consistency ROIs, the voxel level correlations are on average higher than in the low consistency ROIs. So for each of those ROIs, we calculated the voxel level correlation matrix. Now note that the dimensions vary from ROI to ROI, because they are of different size. So the upper one is around 300 times 300, then we have 400 something times 400 something, 400 times 400, and the last one is actually really small, or pretty small, 200 times 200. And what we see here is we have one ROI that has just uniformly low correlation between voxels. That is probably badly defined. Like the ROI boundaries are just in the wrong place. That area is never homogeneous. In all the other ones, however, we see modules of the voxel level network appearing and disappearing inside the ROIs over time. So it's not just the whole ROI being of low correlation and high correlation, but it's actually modules appearing and disappearing. We don't know exactly what was the meaning or message of these modules appearing. We just speculated that they might be connected to the network topology. Basically, if we have a region who is a bridge builder, for example, here, who needs to create links to different directions, it might be that such region would advance from having internal communities of differently behaving voxels. That is, at this stage, pure speculation. So, to conclude, we found out that consistency changes in time. So it's not just like on average low, but it changes. This may reflect changes in activation. Our stimulus doesn't allow to checking for that. We have seen that the ROIs have time-dependent internal structure, which may relate to network topology. And based on all this, that was actually the point when this question first raised. Is it even possible to define a set of ROIs that would be stable, same always, and homogeneous also always? Can we actually capture the network structure of the brain with static nodes? Which is kind of scary. Typically we have elements that don't change and connections between them that do change. And now I'm asking, can we actually create a proper network with elements that don't change? Now,
question from Sebastian again before we move on. Can I ask for some details of the pre-processing pipeline? Did you do global signal regression?
Yes, in all of these, if I now remember correctly, we did global signal regression, yes. Honestly speaking, it's not fair to ask somebody about the details of pre-processing that has been done 4 years back. But yes, if I remember right, we did. So, I'm now moving on to some work that is not finished yet. This one is pretty close to be finished, about the internal connectivity and topological roles of nodes in functional brain networks. So basically, how is what happens inside ROIs related to network structure? This again with Elisa. I know my told she left the academy, but she's doing this as a hobby project. I'll get her back one day. And with Anna-Priana, who is doing her PhD at Aalto, and Jari is our prof in Aalto as well. So last time we asked, does consistency change in time? Now we ask, why does it change? And in particular, is the consistency, are changes in consistency connected to network structure? Again, we have two sets of data, the same ones as in the previous study. We have ROIs from the brain atom parcellation in two different spaces. Basically, in the native space of each subject, I will show results for the native space, And then we have calculated also in the standard space. So for those who don't have background in neuroscience, basically in order to do group level studies, we need to transform the data from the individual anatomy of each subject to some sort of like average anatomy, that's the standard space. And there is ongoing discussion where should be the network studies actually be done, in the native space or in the standard space. So we did both. We also tested two link definition approaches. In the results I'll show you, we have used Pearson correlation. Just as a curiosity, I mentioned we also used the coarse-graining idea of Rainer Kujala and others, where the idea was that we first detected modules of voxels and then calculated how many voxel level links there are between those modules, and then used the modules as ROIs and the sum or like the total number of voxel level links as links of the ROI level network. But I'll now show results for the Pearson correlation. This was a prediction study, so basically we used different measures of internal connectivity and consistency to predict the topological role of the nodes. So this is now actually something that contains a network. So we had six predictors. One was just the size of ROIs, a number of voxels inside, and then five measures of internal connectivity. Most of them already familiar to you, spatial consistency, spatiotemporal consistency, then the standard deviation of correlations inside ROIs. So this is just to like somehow trying to quantify how much variation there is between voxels. Self-link weight, which is the number of voxel level links inside the ROI or number of significant voxel level correlations inside the ROI, and internal density, that is just the normalized version, because of course bigger or large ROIs can have more internal links than the small ones. Then the topological roles we were trying to predict. We had global hubness defined by Klim and others, which basically asks how central the node is compared to a random node in a random network of the same size. And that was actually a weighted version, so we used the strength of the node compared to the mean and standard deviation of the strength of a random node in a random network. And then we also calculated connectorness, basically telling is that node building bridges between different parts of the network, and that was just the proportion of all links of that node that are long. So we set a threshold. I think in these results the threshold was 50%, so basically we asked accuracies that are higher than random, and in particular we noticed that spatial consistency is the measure that tells if a node is hub or not. So ROIs with high consistency tend to be hubs. For the connectorness, our accuracies were lower. When again using the ROI size, that's on the left, we noticed that ROI size is by far the most important predictor of connectorness. So basically large ROIs tend to be connectors. And that might be partly just because they are able to build more links, because they are large, they have more voxels. So we again repeated without the ROI size. The results are on the right. Now our accuracy is not too much above random. We are still above random, but not too much. And there we can see that the measures that possibly have a predictive role here are the spatial consistency and then also spatiotemporal consistency. The others have a very minor role. We are still working on the kind of neuroscientific interpretation of these measures, like what does it mean that high consistency ROIs are bridge builders? Why is it so? To conclude this one, basically what we have seen here is that internal connectivity measures or measures of internal structure to some extent predict topological roles, which means that there is actually a connection between consistency, internal structure, and the network topology. So definitely, the time-dependent homogeneity we have seen is not a technical flaw. That means that it can't be fixed by introducing other set of static nodes. However, on the other hand, we know that for observing the ROI time series, we average voxels. If any static ROI we have is kind of predestinate to have low consistency at some point, that means that we can't average without losing data. In order to construct accurate brain networks, we indeed do need to have time-dependent nodes. And now I will close with my personal idea how we actually should construct brain networks. It's also ongoing.
One more quick question about how you define the weight of self-loops in the last study.
Sorry?
You had self-edges in your network in the last study.
Yes.
And Sebastian wanted to know how you compute the weights for the self-edges.
Yes. So basically for the self-edges, we first calculated all the correlations between voxels belonging to the same ROI, and then set a threshold, and then calculated the number of those correlations that were above the threshold, and then the self-link weight was just the number of those above threshold correlations.
So that would mean if you have a larger ROI, then you can have a large self-edge weight, whereas if your ROI is very small in the beginning, then you're kind of limited to how large a self-weight can be, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's why we used also the like size normalized version. Mm-hmm. So the density, that was then basically which proportion of the possible voxel level links were above the threshold. Indeed. So this last piece of ongoing stuff is about multi-layer brain networks with flexible or time-dependent nodes. Again, with some people from Aalto, Finland, but different people. Tarmo is doing his PhD, Maria just graduated, Iiro is an assistant prof with beautiful fMRI data. I'm really grateful for him because he gave me data. And then Mikko Kivelä is the multi-layer network guru, so it's great to have him in the project. And this now just idea or concept, I won't show any results. But so my idea about how we should construct functional brain networks is based on the theory of multilayer networks. As we probably all know, multilayers are presenting different connections in the same network, each type of connections on their own layer. Typical examples, again, social networks with friendships on one layer, kinship on other one, some sort of enmity on other one, or transportation networks with buses and trains and planes on different layers. In our network, the layers will represent time windows. And actually the data we have in Aalto is beautiful because it has a very good being fMRI time resolution. So we actually will have long time series. We will be able to have networks of like tens of layers, which is cool compared to our earlier five time windows. Inside each layer, we are going to define the ROIs in a way that optimizes or maximizes their functional homogeneity. And this now actually just a community detection problem, in a sense, or clustering problem. We have the voxels, we have their time series, and we want to divide them into ROIs in a way that maximizes the similarity inside ROI. So as I told you, everybody wants to have their own community detection method. One limitation is that we want them to be spatially continuous to keep some sort of like neuroscientific or anatomical interpretation. Inside the layers, our links will be person correlation coefficients. So just constructing a normal functional brain network inside each of the layers. And between the layers, the links will represent spatial overlap. So basically, if a ROI has changed a lot, there will be only a very weak link between its replicas on different layers. If it hasn't changed, there will be a strong link. And if it has, for example, somehow divided into two, then there will be more complicated intralayer structures, like this ROI dividing to that guy and that one and so on. What we are wishing to be able to detect from there is some sort of structure of semi-stable states or mesostable states, so that we would see that, okay, for a while the ROIs don't change and then suddenly something happens. Our stimulus is a story. The subjects are listening to a story in the scanner. So, like, best case scenario would be something happens in the story that makes the brain to reorganize and we would see only weak links between the layers. But I can't show you results yet. I hope I'll be able to do that later this year. So, I'll now conclude the whole thing. If you remember one thing from this talk, that should be that it's not trivial to construct a functional brain network. Applies to constructing any network from time series. Actually, exactly same tools are used for example, constructing networks of stocks in the market. There are time series of stock prices, and then you construct networks. So every time when you start constructing a network, be aware of your methods, know what you are doing, and pay attention on what you should not be doing, and especially if the situation is not straightforward. Then if you want to remember another thing, that should probably be that the nodes, the ROIs, are typically not functionally homogeneous. This applies to basically each and every network neuroscience study ever done. So there is a possibility that some of the results are actually corrupted by spurious connectivity. We have seen that the homogeneity consistency changes in time, which might be related to changes in function of brain areas, and which is also related to their role in the network topology. So we have seen that the low homogeneity, it's not a technical issue. It can't be fixed by introducing a new set of ROIs, saying, that, okay, these are still static, but these are better. So we actually need ROIs that do change in time. This is an ugly slide of references. I'll just have it here so that if you want to get back to any of them, you can do that later. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, any comments, I'm happy to answer. Either now or then later, you can just find me in Twitter or even send me email. And as I said, the slides are available online. The link can be seen down there. Thanks.
Thanks, Onerva. So we've already got a question from Yusuf. Yusuf, do you want to just unmute yourself and ask it to Onerva directly? Or I can ask on your behalf, whatever you prefer.
Okay. Thank you for this very beautiful talk. I just have a more general question. Although the specifics was brilliant in this presentation, in general, I'm interested in dynamic functional connectivity. And there are various methods to do that. But the most simple one seems to be the sliding window. And I can understand it easily. There are other more complicated methods, but I am more on the structural side. So functional is quite like magic for me. But I can understand how the sliding window works. But it looks like reviewer number two is going to reject if I do something using this method. So what would be your suggestions for properly doing sliding window, or if there is any other methods that I can get dynamic functional connectivity without getting into black magic? So I will appreciate any suggestion on that.
And I see no like specific problem in using them. It's and of course, if you use sliding windows, then you probably shouldn't, for example, compare the networks you observe in different windows, because especially if you have a sliding window with a very large overlap, so just like sliding one sample by sample, then basically the networks of different windows are mostly constructed from the same data. So it's kind of something to be aware of. And then if there are time series that are long enough, which typically should be then MEG-EEG, then you can of course use windows that are not actually sliding, but that are just like not overlapping. And in that case, you can then actually compare the networks to see some changes. So I think they are just like measuring a bit of different things. The sliding window thing is more like for detecting more like continuous changes, and then the non-overlapping windows could be used actually for like comparing what changed from here to there. And then actually what is done a lot is also just, for example, measure doing different tasks and compare those. That's not actually dynamic, of course, but that is also like used to address the question, how do the networks change? I'm sorry, but I can't really give like clear recommendations on what should be done.
I'm afraid that there's still a lot to be done.
Yes. The first thing would be to collect enough data and then store it in a format where you actually can do dynamic things. Because, for example, now I have here in Madrid MEG and EEG data that has been collected in trials, saved in trials, and now we don't know what is the correct order of the trials, which basically means that we can't do any dynamic networks because we have a beautiful temporal shuffling of the data.
So we have another question from Sebastian. Do you want to ask it yourself?
Sure, thank you. Thanks for the interesting talk. I was curious to hear you talk a little bit more about how you were doing your overlapping node definition. That you were thinking about spatial homogeneity somehow, or that somehow ensuring that your nodes don't move too far? Yes,
I didn't get into details because I don't know the details yet. So basically I have been for the previous year or so testing a lot of different methods for doing that. But most probably what we are going to do is to start from a set of seed voxels. They can be either like anatomically motivated, I have used the centroids of the brain atom regions, or then they can be just random, or then they can be otherwise specified. But then the idea would be to start from the seeds and start adding to the seed those neighbors of the seed that are leading to the highest spatial consistency or highest homogeneity, and then always increase each of the ROIs by adding the neighboring voxels that are giving the highest homogeneity. So that would both keep them spatially continuous, and then yes, to some extent ensure some sort of like spatial homogeneity, because the seeds could be same on each layer. So then we could still like identify the error by saying that okay, this blob of voxels is in some sense same as this one, even if they move.
Yeah, have you thought about mixing this with something like the coactivation patterns approach, or like a hidden Markov model, so that you like at least have some, like don't have to do all the work of, or rather my feeling is that if you did like looked at something like coactivation patterns or hidden Markov model, you'd be able to at least find a reasonable number of substates.
Yes.
I mean, it may actually be against, like, not what you're hoping for in this, but I'm curious if having fewer, more consistent networks where you're doing this node definition is going to, like, lead you to have better results.
Yes. But so that would be more like about defining the kind of optimal number of states over time, but not actually defining the number or location of the nodes inside layers, if I understand correctly.
Right, right.
Yes.
Thank you.
Do you
want to
go next?
Sure, hi. I'm wondering if you looked into minimum description length for searching your subgroups or ROIs. Yeah, I think it should be doable when you model the homogeneity in there. But
yes.
I'm also thinking out loud, so.
we didn't, but thanks for thinking out loud, because that would definitely be a thing to try. I'm really, really open to that, all sort of thinking out loud about how to define the ROIs, because I don't have an... If I had an optimal way, I would have told you.
Okay, cool. Then I might be in touch as soon as I find my solution. It might fit your solution as well.
Okay.
So I was briefly kicked out during the Q&A. So somebody posted a question in the chat and I didn't call on you. Please just go ahead and jump right in, because the chat wiped itself when I came back in. Otherwise, so I wanted to ask you something about, you started off comparing voxels and ROI, and I've learned a lot about why the kind of static ROIs don't can't even possibly work quite as well as one would want them to. Mm-hmm. The whole moving it to more flexible ROIs sounds really, really cool to me, but I was wondering the kind of the main point of why we discarded the idea of just having a voxel network was that it doesn't, you can't feed it into MATLAB.
No, I'm sorry, but I can't. Now I think I lost some of important keywords of your question because of the connection issue.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on. My connection today is really bad. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Better now?
Yes.
Okay. So we discarded the idea of using a network where the nodes are voxels because of RAM issues with MATLAB. Was that it? Or were there other good reasons to discard the idea of using the voxels themselves as nodes?
Yes, exactly. That MATLAB thing has been like a historical detail, but that's still repeated in papers, that because of the huge computational load, we can't use voxels. But also, basically in all voxel-level studies, because they do voxel-level studies of activation or like function in fMRI, they have noticed that almost always there are blobs of activation that are larger than single voxels. And also historically, there is a lot of knowledge about brain areas that for some reason are thought to be like homogeneous, starting from Corbinian Broadman, who actually did the cell level studies of brain in the early 20th century. So they are actually brain areas that have similar types of cell inside the area, and then they are cell-wise, can you say, so cell-wise different from the rest of the brain. And then also it has been found out in the studies of function that there are voxels that tend to activate together. So there seems to be something that is larger than voxels, and that's why we are actually hunting for the ROIs. Of course, it like independent of what programming language or computational interface one is using, it would be nicer to handle a network of a couple of hundreds of nodes than a network of tens of thousands, of thousands of nodes, just like to be more intuitive. And then also, it's often said that yes, but the voxels are the imaging resolution, it's the highest resolution we get, we should use them, but the voxels are actually already really far away from the level of neurons. So when we study the voxel level networks, we actually do a lot of averaging, kind of without seeing it, just for observing the voxel time series. And in a sense, the voxels are totally arbitrary because they are just like cubes of the brain matter. So it's just a, like grid set on the brain, and then that's how we get the voxels. So in a sense, clumping the voxels together might be more intuitive for interpreting in the like neuroscientific context.
Right.
In a sense, we would like to have areas that have some sort of name and meaning instead of just being a voxel at those coordinates. It feels really arbitrary. For example, if you search for hubs of the network, to say that, okay, voxel at those coordinates was hub. Well, then why wasn't the neighboring voxel a hub? What was the difference between those two? So
right.
That's the like motivation for using large areas.
Yeah. So my kind of entryway into networks was originally from dynamical systems. So when I think of taking a network that has a lot of nodes in it, and then you want to condense it down to a network that has fewer nodes, to me it sounds like you're taking a high dimensional dynamical system and you're trying to reduce the dimensions so that you have a lower dynamical system. And like, obviously there's like lots of methods that people use to do dimensionality reduction. And like somebody would have tried that with similar data that you're looking at. So it's like the issue was, it's the problem that you don't get kind of spatially segregated modes when you do things like singular value decomposition and these types of things.
Yes.
Okay.
That has been, I'm pretty sure somebody has tried that as well, but yes, the spatiality is a big issue because the brain actually, there's also a big difference between brain networks and many other types of networks, that the brain actually lives in space and the spatial location matters. So every time when I see a sort of introduction to networks lecture, where they tell that the big thing is in networks is that the spatial location of areas doesn't matter, then I kind of question that, because in brain it actually does. And yes, for the sake of interpretation, we really want to have our ROIs to be continuous. But actually, although I have now been talking about flexible ROIs, I think this basically also like change in the way of thinking that we need, that actually we are studying a voxel level network, and then we are just detecting spatially continuous communities in that voxel level network and allowing those communities to change. So in a sense, one could even say that the way to go is to study voxel level networks, but study the communities in them.
I'm just going to buy a lot more RAM. Okay, so if there's no further questions, I think we're already well over time, but this was a really interesting discussion. Thank you so much, Onerva, for this really interesting talk and for the lively discussion that we had afterwards. And I'll see you all again next week. There'll be a reminder about the seminar next week soon.
Yes, see you, and thanks for the discussion, and thanks for not having me around, basically.
Take care.